Thank you for joining us today. We'll be discussing patients' postoperative pain. We will do this today by discussing the relationship between postoperative pain and opioids, and then discuss some ways to manage competing goals, in addition to how to navigate difficult conversations. All of these headlines that you see here are from non-medical journals over the past couple of years, talking about the impact of the opioid crisis. This has had a massive effect, and more people continue to die nationally and in Kentucky from the opioid epidemic. This graph shows the likelihood of opioid-naive patients still being on an opioid at 1 in 3 years after receiving their first opioid prescription based on the number of days supply they are written for. The 1 year is shown by the solid line, and 3 years is shown by the dotted line. You can see that patients provided a 1 month prescription have about a 35% chance of still being on their prescription at a year, and a 20% chance at 3 years. But even just providing a patient with a 1 day supply carries risk, with a rate of around 5%. There's a fairly clear correlation between extent of initial opioid exposure and long-term use. Adding this to data suggesting little benefit of chronic opioid therapy for most patients, we can begin to understand the potential risk of overuse of post-operative opioids. Additionally, many patients don't use all of their opioids that they are prescribed. On average, 80% of patients across 7 surgical populations reported having unused opioids after surgery. This, however, contradicts one of the concerns voiced by providers, that patients may call for a refill. However, research suggests that less than 2% of patients will actually need a refill, and that refill requests don't increase when providers decrease the day supply of opioids prescribed. In other words, the patients who call for a refill appear to do so regardless of the number of pills they are initially prescribed. The Annals of Surgery published an editorial regarding opioids, but unfortunately, there are few public guidelines to provide adequate guidance on how many days' supply a patient should receive after specific surgeries. More studies are being published, but there's no current standard on what the right thing is to do for each type of surgery. Many providers will rely on what they were taught during surgical training, but this may not be a focus in programs, or differentiations may not be made between acute and chronic pain. But we do know that overprescribing opioids will lead to a 1 in 20 or 5% of patients requiring opioids for longer than their surgical care. Start with setting expectations for pain management at the initial encounter. Not only does this give you an opportunity to describe legal boundaries for opioid prescribing, but more importantly, it allows you to have a conversation with the patient about reasonable expectation for pain management ahead of time. This allows patients to mentally prepare for the pain, which may help pain control postoperatively. For example, it's important to discuss that while pain will be managed, it will be unlikely that they will have no pain immediately after surgery, or that medications can relieve all the pain. Should opioids be needed, it's important to take the time to explain the risks of opioids that come along with the benefits of pain control, and then also discuss non-opioid options such as acetaminophen and ibuprofen, pointing out that they may work better for certain types of pain and that multiple pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic modalities may be used to treat their postoperative pain outside of opioids. Once the patient is in the postoperative setting, you can work with the prepared patient to reflect on their expectations coming in and discuss a multimodal approach to pain control. Keeping your practice consistent can also aid in making sure all modalities are utilized and people are not discharged home with excessive opioids. As you move through the patient's stay and you discharge the patient, avoid writing prescriptions just in case they may need them. As we saw before, many patients will not use their entire prescription that's dispensed. Electronic prescribing also allows for C2 prescriptions to be electronically conveyed without requiring the patient to pick up a paper prescription. For those patients with extra opioids at home who no longer require them, it's also important to educate them on how to dispose of them. For patients that are high risk for opioid overdose, it also may be appropriate to prescribe naloxone for home. throughout the entire process, you'll have to use your medical expertise to help patients understand how much pain is appropriate and the impacts, both positive and negative, of possible interventions. At the same time, external forces may pressure you to modify your behavior. Legislated prescribing limits, fear of lawsuits, and public reporting of iatrogenic opioid dependence all complicate clinical care and decision making. The next few quotes are taken from 17 surgical residents that participated in a study with Elizabeth Adams in 2016. I'm not going to read the quotes to you, but they each demonstrate competing priorities that these providers dealt with when managing patients' pain. You have to set expectations as early as possible and reinforce these throughout your time with the patient. While you understand that there may be more pressing needs than opioid use and pain control at any given moment, the patient and other providers may not. Be empathetic, but you may need to redirect patients towards more pressing clinical needs. We'll move into discussing three different subsets of patients you may encounter. We'll start with opioid-naive patients. Even these patients can present with preconceived notions about opioids based on others' experiences or what they have seen on the news. You'll have to take the lead on educating this patient, although this is a group effort. Detective work may be needed if the patient exhibits resistance or fear of opioids. However, oftentimes these patients may defer to your clinical judgment and go with whatever plan you put in place. It will also be important for these opioid-naive patients to identify clear endpoints of therapy for their pain control. Instead of getting a patient's pain to a number, work on establishing function-based goals. Then, if an intervention isn't helping the patient achieve that goal, for example, walking, you can reassess its place in therapy. Given the multitude of options for pain control, opioids typically don't need to be scheduled for patients who are opioid naive preoperatively. Let's move on to opioid experienced patients, who may be a little bit more complicated. These patients are either on opioids at home or have received opioids in the past. From those experiences, they may have preconceived notions and have different expectations about how their pain will be managed. When helping frame expectations, it's important to differentiate between their chronic and postoperative acute pain. Know that their pain threshold may be different and delineate what they can expect from surgery. Explain that they potentially will need more or different medications due to their difference in tolerance or hypalgesia, but explain what their pain from surgery will be. Make sure that they understand that you are there to treat their surgery-related pain and not necessarily their chronic pain. Doing this up front may help you from having to have more difficult conversations in the future. If you need to, you can lean on legislation saying, "My hands are tied and this is all I'm able to prescribe due to legal regulations." However, you need to be careful not to alienate patients, and it's best to explain that this is all that's allowed because it's oftentimes all that's needed. For high-risk patients, education about naloxone may help them understand the risk associated with their opioid regimen. This can serve as an introduction to a risk-benefit discussion regarding their opioid therapy. Finally, let's discuss opioid-seeking patients who want to exploit and manipulate you to prescribe them opioids. Unfortunately, they may not be forthcoming about their history with opioids. And with these patients, it's important to try and facilitate candor and also again lean on the legal implications of your prescribing decisions. Throughout this difficult conversation, make sure to use non-threatening language to ensure everyone's safety. For all patients, it's important to have four tenets. Invest in your relationship with the patient. Throughout your interactions, be compassionate and empathetic while understanding their preferences and values. This empathy, combined with your medical expertise and reassurance, can help facilitate realistic conversations throughout therapy. However, if things don't feel right, talk to someone with more experience. We'll now go through three different scenarios where you'll be given time to think about what you would do in this situation. You see a gentleman in the clinic who is demanding opioids for the pain he attributes to his recent surgery. He states it's your fault and that you're obligated to fix the problem as you botched his surgery and marred him for life. How would you respond to this situation? In this scenario, you should discuss the surgery when as planned and discuss the functional goals that the patient has been able to reach. You can offer to discuss the patient's pain more, which will show empathy and respect, but this should be done prior to prescribing any more opioids. This will also reinforce your role to the patient as an expert and medical professional. In this scenario, a 60-year-old male comes to the emergency room with acute pain for his fracture he sustained from a fall. He says that the pain is a 10 out of 10 and he's allergic to Tylenol, ibuprofen, and Toradol, but knows that the medication starting with a D works well for his pain. The patient also requests a food tray. He seemingly is in an unbearable pain, given he's asking for a tray. However, dismissing his concerns altogether could escalate the situation and cause him to be combative. Asking about his allergies and specific characteristics of his pain can help establish your role as a medical expert, and you can go from there. In this final scenario, you have a patient that you are discharging after a minor laparoscopic procedure. When the patient sees a standard service line, opioid prescription you've written, they balk and they tell you their pain's a 10. You're aware that the patient goes out to smoke multiple times a day and her Casper has opioid prescriptions from multiple physicians. The patient states that those are for her chronic pain and she's unable to function without those opioids. What would you do in this situation? In this situation, it would be important to inform them that there are legal limits to the amount of opioids that can be prescribed, and that you're only able to treat the pain related to her surgery, in addition to following the service line protocols. By establishing these boundaries, it may help with the tough communication and move the conversation forward. Thank you for listening today. We hope that you found some useful tools to help facilitate these difficult discussions with patients.